You raise some money in stealth for Sierra, you've come out of stealth, and you want to do something that's been talked about a bit in recent months, introduce an AI agent.
Yeah, we're really excited about this. You know, when you leave your job, especially jobs like we have, you want to go towards a big vision. And from Clay and our perspective, conversational AI, I think, is perhaps the most important consumer technology trend of a generation. When you look at it, the advent of the internet and how it impacted companies' ability to interact with their customers digitally, the birth of the smartphone, we think conversational AI is on par with those. And candidly, I think every company is going to need their own AI agent. That's going to be the way you interact with your customers. And I think it will be as important as your mobile app, as important as your website in just a few years.
Clay, you raised some money, two separate rounds, but essentially, I want to know how you guys got together. Interesting careers you've both had so far. Whose idea was it? And why are you working together on this company?
Bret and I have actually known each other for almost 20 years. We met in our early days at Google, where we started our careers, and have kept in touch ever since. And Bret and I both saw this wave of technology change, and we're so excited about the potential in large language models and recent advances in AI, and got together just over a year ago over lunch, actually, and kind of hatched early plans there. And I think, like with most things we do, the idea came from us both. And we worked over the past almost 11 months to really discover and refine it, including with a number of what we call design partners, early pilot customers who've helped us shape the platform and the idea.
Clay, talk about that refining. Hallucinations are what are the key concern and maybe limitations in the here and the now of generative AI more broadly, and chatbots in a generative AI form. What are you seeing, Clay, about improvements in that?
Well, first of all, I think what we've built with Sierra and conversational AI goes far beyond what I think most people will have experienced with chatbots. I think if you polled Bloomberg readers and watchers, do they like chatbots that you use embedded on websites today? Probably 0 of 100 would say yes. But if you polled those same 100 people and asked, do you like talking with ChatGPT? Maybe 100 would say yes. And so the technology underlying Sierra and our AI agents really fundamentally didn't exist much more than a year ago. And so we've built Sierra and the platform on this fundamentally new technology. As for hallucinations, it's a really important issue. And as you know, AI is fundamentally non-deterministic. And using a large language model on its own, you can't guarantee what it will output. So we've taken a multi-layered approach to security, starting with very strict security protocols around whenever our AI agents are taking action and using systems, those are done completely deterministically. We also imbue our agents with knowledge provided to us by our customers and have multiple layers of supervision and oversight, including advanced auditing and inspection tools for our customers to use.
It's interesting that, Bret, we just heard Clay reference ChatGPT, and of course, you are the chair of the board of OpenAI. I'm really interested in when you're building another generative AI company that might well also be seen as a competitor, how you think about that from an ethical perspective.
Well, first, I really don't think OpenAI and Sierra are competitive. I think we'll look back at this year and it'll be sort of like saying you're an internet company today. It doesn't make sense because the internet permeates every business and every decision we make. And I think AI will have a similar impact. And we exist at a sort of a different layer of the stack. We're customers of OpenAI in addition to a number of other foundation models. And obviously at OpenAI, I operate in more of a governance role, not an operational role. And certainly if there's ever an opportunity for conflict, I'd simply recuse myself. And I can say I'm really grateful to be a part of OpenAI. I joined that board and a story that you covered extensively, and I think the mission is more important than ever before, and I'm grateful to be a part of that mission.
Clay, one of the things I've learned in my reporting of OpenAI is that the cap table is complicated and important, but actually access to compute and your strategic partners are equally as important, if not more. What has Sierra done in its access to AI accelerators, on that end of the spectrum, but also what are your relationships with the hyperscalers and your talent base as well?
Well, first of all, the technology approach that we use to building Sierra agents is what's called an autonomous AI agent architecture. And what we do is, rather than relying on a single model, any action that the agent takes might rely on five or six different models for different tasks: reasoning, decision making, planning, generating responses, and more. And so we actually use a constellation of models. We currently work with OpenAI, we work with Azure Cognitive Services, and others on our cloud infrastructure and our model providers. We generally rely on them to provision and provide the underlying hardware that we scale through. So we're a step removed from it, but it's always on our mind. And we've taken multiple steps to ensure that we can plan for capacity and use and so on.
Bret, if you don't mind, I'd like to linger on your CV a bit, because what's happened in the last 12 months is extraordinary. You have companies like yours coming out of stealth, raising vast amounts of money. You said that Clay said you'd put this together in 11 months. But I just want to understand, like, how this process compares to your time at Salesforce, the earlier days at Google. In 11 months, how big has your team grown to? Is it just the two of you in a garage somewhere? You know, I think people don't really have a great sense of what building a startup that rapidly is like.
Well, I've gone from 80,000 employees to 30, and it's been delightful. And actually, let me just contextualize it in sort of the story of Silicon Valley.
Sure.
If you look at the previous significant technology waves, the growth of the internet in the late 90s, the growth of the smartphone in the 2010s, those periods coincide with many startups that start then that become formidable companies. Our two predecessors, Salesforce and Google, were born in the birth of the web browser. Companies like Uber and Lyft that you were just speaking about came to exist because of the birth of the smartphone. So in these moments where there's a significant new technology trend that means new consumer behaviors, new technology models, often new business models, there's really an opportunity for startups to compete again. There's a great Steve Jobs quote that it's more fun to be a pirate than it is to be in the Navy. And there's these moments in Silicon Valley history where you have an opportunity as a smaller company where your agility and your ability to have that unique market perspective is an advantage. It doesn't mean that incumbents don't have advantages, but it's a fun time to be a startup right now, and because no one knows what the future of this technology will bring, and we have an opportunity to define it.
Clay, there are other startups doing this. And I think of Forethought, I think of Ada, and I think of ultimately what holds back. And what you're having to do is to connect with other enterprise systems. I've been talking to Kai-Fu Lee, for example, yesterday, who's saying agents, personal agents, sound like they're going to be really easy to orchestrate, but they're not, because there's going to be pushback from incumbents. How much pushback have you felt? How much have enterprise systems and other big companies already playing in the enterprise space been willing to allow a company agent to navigate with them?
Well, first of all, we've had the privilege of working with many leading consumer brands on actually developing the first version of our platform, brands like Weight Watchers, Sonos, SiriusXM, and Olokai. And we've worked hand in hand with them to develop our CR platform and the agent architecture to make sure that it's trustworthy, that it can integrate seamlessly and easily and is easy to deploy with their systems, and that the experience it delivers for their customers is really delightful. And so you're right, in order to have these agents able to take action on behalf of your customers, there is some work to do to integrate with systems and your knowledge bases and so on. We're really proud of how easy we've made that. And in fact, a Sierra agent can be deployed in just a matter of weeks.
Our colleague Katie Roof broke the story about your fundraises and the near valuation of $1 billion. What justifies those numbers? You kind of tease some of the customers that you worked with in the development process. We mentioned Airbnb has an ambition to integrate agents, I suppose, into their customer service offering. Who are you talking to? You know, how quickly do you commercialize this, Bret?
Well, number one, we're really focused on our customers. We're really focused on the largest consumer brands, who I think would benefit the most from this conversational AI. I think they'll save the most in operating
expenses.
Not just retailers. If you think of, we partnered with media companies, all subscription services, airlines, travel companies. We think there's in really broad consumer categories that can benefit from this. And as Clay said, the unique requirements of these larger enterprises, I think Sierra is uniquely able to handle. You talk about valuations. You know, it's funny. You talk about the dot-com bubble, and I think a lot of people think of pets.com and Webvan.
Yes.
If you could go back in time and buy an index fund of all of those dot-com companies, you'd also get Amazon, you'd also get Google, you'd get eBay, you'd get PayPal, and you probably would make a ton. I think as you're looking at investment right now, it's certainly frothy. It's certainly a bit of an AI bubble. However, I think the thesis that out of this AI wave will come many generational companies uniquely built on this technology is probably true. So I think it's probably both true that there's a lot of hype and that this technology wave is going to fundamentally change the way we interact with consumers and fundamentally change the market of the technology economy. And I think it's exciting. So I think we have a lot of work to do to justify the faith that our investors have in us, but I could not be more optimistic about the future.